Vasudevaya.
Om namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, translation and commentary by Srila Prabhupada. Canto 7, The Science of God. Chapter 15, Instructions for Civilized Human Beings. Text number 47.
Pravrittam cha
nivrittam
cha
vividham
karma
vairikam
avartate
pravrittena
nivrittena
ashnute
amritam
Pravrittim cha nivrittim cha
vividham karma vaidikam
avartate pravrittena
nivrittena
shrutimritam
pravrittam cha nivrittam cha
vividham karma vaidikam
Vividham karma vaidikam
avartate
pravrittena
nivrittena shnute mritam
nivrittena shnute mritam pravrittam cha nivrittam cha
vividham karma
vaidikam
avartate
pravrittena
nivrittena shnute
Nivritte nasude vritam.
Pravrittam cha, nivrittam cha.
Pravrittam cha, nivrittam cha.
Dvividham karma vaidikam.
Dvividham karma vaidikam.
Avartate pravritte na.
Avartate pravritte na.
Nivritte nasude vritam.
Nivritte nasude vritam.
Pravrittam cha, nivrittam cha.
Pravrittam cha, nivrittam cha. Vividham karma vaidikam
avartate pravrittena
nivrittena
shnute
amritam pravrittam cha nivrittam cha
vividham
karma vaidikam
avartate pravrittena
nivrittena shnute amritam pravrittam cha nivrittam
cha
vividham karma vaidikam avrutate pravrittena nivrittena shnute amritam pravrittam cha nivrittam cha vividham karma vaidikam
avartate pravrittena
nivrittena shnute amritam
pravrittam inclined for material enjoyment cha
and
nivrittam
cessation of material enjoyment
Cha
and
Vividham.
These two varieties.
Karma
of activities.
Vaidikam. Recommended in the Vedas.
Avartate.
One travels up and down through the cycle of samsara.
Pravrittena.
By an inclination for enjoying material activities.
Nivrittena.
But by ceasing such activities.
Ashnute.
One enjoys.
Amritam.
Eternal life.
eternal life.
Translation: according to the Vedas, there are two kinds of activities, pravritti and nivritti. Pravritti activities involve raising oneself from a lower to a higher condition of materialistic life, whereas nivritti means the cessation of material desire. Through pravritti activities, one suffers from material entanglement, but by nivritti activities, one is purified and becomes fit to enjoy eternal blissful life. Please repeat, according to the Vedas.
According to the Vedas.
There are two kinds of activities.
There are two kinds of activities.
Pravritti and nivritti.
Pravritti and nivritti.
Pravritti activities involve raising oneself.
Pravritti activities involve raising oneself.
From a lower to a higher condition of materialistic life. Whereas nivritti means.
Whereas nivritti means.
The cessation of material desire.
The cessation of material desire.
Through pravritti activities, one suffers from material entanglement.
Through pravritti activities, one suffers from material entanglement.
But by nivritti activities, one is purified.
But by nivritti activities, one is purified.
And becomes fit to enjoy eternal blissful life.
And becomes fit to enjoy eternal blissful life.
I'm going to need a Gita again. Srila Prabhupada's purport, as confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 16.7, Pravrittim cha nivrittim cha jana navidurasura. The asuras, non-devotees, cannot distinguish between pravritti and nivritti. Whatever they like, they do. Such persons think themselves independent of the strong material nature, and therefore they are irresponsible and do not care to act piously. Indeed, they do not distinguish between pious and impious activity. Bhakti, of course, does not depend on pious or impious activity. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 126, Savai Pumsam Puro Dharmo Yato Bhakti Vibhokshaje Ahaitu Kya Pratihata Yayatma Suprasidati. Quote, the supreme occupation, dharma for all humanity, is that by which men can attain to loving devotional service unto the transcendent Lord. Such devotional service must be unmotivated and uninterrupted in order to completely satisfy the self. Nonetheless, those who act piously have a better chance to become devotees. As Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita 7.16, Chaturvedā vajante mam janāt sukriti norjuna. O Arjuna, four kinds of pious men render devotional service unto me. One who takes a devotional service, even with some material motive, is considered pious. And because he has come to Krishna, he will gradually come to the stage of bhakti. Then, like Dhruva Maharaj, he will refuse to accept any material benediction from the Lord. Therefore, even if one is material inclined, one may take to the shelter of the lotus feet of, and here it is for the third purport in a row, Krishna and Balaram, or Gaura Nitai. I was really in the mood, huh? Let's see, 7 p.m. In the summer of 76, he's translating this. What was going on? Anyway, who knows? So that he will very soon be purified of all material desires. Kshipram bhavati dharmatma sashvat chantin vikapjati. As soon as one is free from inclinations toward pious and impious activities, he becomes a perfect candidate for returning home back to back. Om Ajnana Tivarandasya Gyananjana Salakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. I was born in the darkest ignorance of my spiritual master, Open mine eyes with the torch of knowledge, and offer my respectful obeisances unto him. So, on a walk yesterday, Gornitai asked me, Gornitai, you got a good name for these purports. You know, something like, how did you come to Krishna consciousness, or something like that. And I told him that I was a typical frustrated student. Looking for the truth, wasn't finding it in the university. And finally, when I read Prabhupada's Gita, wow, that was it. But what I forgot to tell you was that actually, before I read Prabhupada's Gita, you know, I fancied myself a seeker, right? Seeker of the truth. And I was actually developing these, we say in English, psychosomatic symptoms. In other words, because of what's going on in your mind, it manifests in your body, right? That I was being strangled. And what I was feeling was that nothing made sense. Everything was contradictory in the material world, because it's full of duality. You know, for every reason you can think of doing something, there's another reason not to do it. Right? For every pro, there's a con. For every plus, there's a minus. And it was driving me crazy, you know, because nothing really made sense. This is the existential dilemma. You know, the existentialists, one famous existentialist said, the only question worth asking oneself is, should I kill myself or not? Because life is absurd. That was the question. That was kabul. And one fine night, he answered it in the affirmative, and he drove off. I think he drove his car off a cliff or something, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's how I was feeling. I was feeling, boy, this is like, I felt it was like the noose was getting tighter and tighter. And then when I finally read Prabhupada's Gita, did you ever have a chiropractic adjustment? Did you ever have a good one where there's a real release? You know, a real release of a lock, you know, what do they call it in chiropractic? I forget. Anyway, I once was in a car accident and it took 6 weeks for this chiropractor to unlock me. I was all jammed up, you know, my spine. And finally he hit it. And all the tension was gone. So when I read Prabhupada's Gita, and I understood a little bit, at least theoretically, of Achinchabeya Vedatattva, how the source of everything is inconceivably simultaneously one with and yet different from everything else. So it's not that Krishna is really responsible for our activities. You know, he gives us free will. And we're free to choose how to be controlled. That's what our free will comes down to. How to be controlled by Krishna directly, out of love, or indirectly through his laws of nature. So pravritti nivritti, the first line, of course, is an echo of the Gita verse. The Prabhupada quotes, those of Ardhamaniya do not know what is to be done, nor what is not to be done. Why? Because we start in the material world, we start with ourselves. So when you start with yourself, your false sense of self, your false, illusory, independent self, then nothing makes sense, because whether you do something or you don't do something, it doesn't work out. And whether you do something this or that, you know, nothing works out. However, there are three modes of material nature, and that's why Prabhupada at one point in the purport returns. And he says, nonetheless, those who act piously have a better chance to become devotees. That's because you're more likely to take off if you go to the airport. I think I talked about that before, right? Yeah. So, 14.6. Gita, tantra sattvam virvalabha, prakasha kamanamayam, sukha sangena badnati, jnana sangena chanaka. O sinless one, the mode of goodness being purer than the others is illuminating, and it purifies one of all sinful reactions. Well, he doesn't want to look at somebody who's a little weird, maybe. I don't blame him. Those who are situated in this mode develop knowledge, but they become conditioned by the concept of happiness. So goodness is good. And it makes us, in our distress, turn to God. You know, and if we're too, you know, resentful of God, then we don't turn to God. We just get more and more bitter, and we just stew in our own anger. Just like there was a famous one of those guys that wrote these, the God Delusion, or one of those books. I forget which one it was. He's still alive, I think, the God Delusion guy. But then there's another one who also made his career out of trying to, you know, mock and disprove theism. And then he caught cancer, and then he died. What's the guy's name, right?
Christopher Hitchens.
Christopher Hitchens. Hitchens?
Hitchens.
Or Hutchins or Hitchens?
No, Hitchin.
Hitchin.
Hitchens.
Hitchens, okay. So he was so, he became, as he was approaching death, he was becoming so mad, not at the impending death, but by all the people who were trying to help him turn to God, you know, and he was like, this is driving me nuts. This is Krishna's way of trying to help him, right? And he was so mad. No, I don't need you. So you're delusion, I don't need your fairy tales. So unfortunate. So we come to Krishna for these four reasons, and they go from kind of gross to subtle. You know, I mean, probably, at least I can identify myself with those four reasons. Chatur Vidava Jantima, Janak Sukhitin Orjana, Arto, we're distressed. Artarto, we're broke. We want wealth, you know, because we're having money. Gyana, Artarti, Gyani, what is it?
Gyani
Chidyasur, yeah, we're curious. I mean, there's something to this, you know, there's something beyond. Gyani Chabaratash, oh, we're a little wise, you know, yeah, there is, must be some intelligent designer, I mean, we think in Dharma. And let me try to find him. Who is he? What is he? So we usually come for a combination, I think, of those reasons, at least I did. I was thinking I was a seeker of the truth. I was inviting in the university. So there's a little bit of Gani in there. But I was also being chased by the American military. They wanted me to go to fight in Vietnam, but we didn't believe in Vietnam. We knew it was a terrible war. It wasn't, you know, there was no real cause. There was no Hitler there. It was just America doing its imperialistic thing. But the very reasons that we come to Krishna, you know, those gross to subtle, suffering, curious, wise, wants some money. Oh, that's a good one. Bhakti Tirtha Swami used to tell the story that years after he became a devotee, an old friend of his from Princeton, Bhakti Tirtha Swami went to an Ivy League school in America, Princeton, and he was the president of his class. And he excelled. And this classmate of his called him up some years later, after Bhakti Tirtha Swami had taken sannyas and was doing all this innovative preaching, you know, in Africa, and the UN, New Age. Bhakti Tirtha Swami was a real innovator. Therefore, he was often misunderstood in his time. So anyway, Bhakti Tirtha Swami told the story that this friend contacted him, and he knew this person had always been a materialist and kind of an atheist, but now he was really interested in what his friend John Faber was doing. John, I think you're a big leader in the Hare Krishna movement. I really liked him. Come and visit you and find out what this is all about. So Bhakti Tirtha Swami thought that maybe his old friend was turning to God. So he came, I'm not sure where he came, maybe in the Washington area, because before Maharaj relocated to Devanagari, he was based in D.C. So he his friend was with him for some time, and then one day, Bhaktivedanta Swami asked him, you know, what his motive was. We have here unmotivated and uninterrupted. Well, here was the motive of the reason the person was trying to find out about Krishna consciousness. Because he noticed, and he was very frank about it, he said, I've noticed that those who become big religious leaders, they have the most power. He wanted power. He wanted to control people. And he wanted to be really successful materially, so he thought he would look at religion. And Bhaktivedanta Swami was like shocked, you know, oh my God, this is why he wants to. Because power is, as Mao Zedong's wife once said, you know, remember Mao Zedong? Mao Zedong, Chinese revolutionary. His wife was pretty smart too, and so she said, most people are bewildered by sex because they've never tasted power. Wow. The ultimate intoxicant, right? Power. They want to control and thereby enjoy. So, the very reasons we approach Krishna for, we don't approach Krishna because we're angels. I mean, we're here to forget it. That's what we've come. He, after a few weeks in the temple, he said to Swamiji, Swamiji, if Krishna is all attractive, then why is it so hard to surrender to him? So without missing a beat, Swamiji said, because you hate him. But as it is, you know, we become perverted. And what's the how I felt verse in the Gita, which confirms what Prabhupada said, you know, Prabhupada sometimes would quote a certain verse which would tell us why we felt in the material world. You know the verse? Seventh chapter.
Icha
Vrishna. Yeah, there it is, very good. Icha Vrishna. O Sayan Bharat, O conqueror of the foe, all living entities are born into delusion. Overcome by the dualities of desire. I want to be the supreme.
Yes.
And hate. And we actually hate the one who is really supreme. That's our impression. That's the complete perversion by the motives. Okay, so the solution is, the prophet says, indeed they, people who don't know what to do, what not to do, do not distinguish between pious and impious activity. Whatever works, you know, whatever is good for me. You know, I'm following the presidential campaign. I have an idea. I want to write a BTG piece about this circus. You know, after the fact, we'll see what animal wins the circus. You know, politicians are famous for this. That's why Chanakya says, I'm going to get in trouble now, you know, the Chanakya Shloka. Never trust a politician or a woman. Of course, that doesn't mean Vaishnavis. So, but politicians will say anything and do anything. Right? Just listen to Donald Trump. So, they say anything, do anything, just to, for their own, what they conceive as their self-interest, without knowing who I am and my self-interest is. Bhakti, of course, does not depend on pious or impious activity. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam, Prabhupada quotes the famous verse, which is really what the Bhagavatam contributes, ultimately, to the religious conversation of this world. The idea, the very idea that pure love of God is free from any desire, from karma, jnana, and yoga. This is not really understood in Kali Yuga by the modern religionists that you're approaching God from alloy and devotional service. That's revolutionary, actually. And that's what Prabhupada brought to the religious conversation. That's concept of who I am. And when you have thus learned the truth, it's the often-neglected follow-up verse to tell you to believe, just try to learn the truth, and then what's the next verse? And when you have thus learned the truth, you know that all living beings are a part of me, they are in me, and I'm mine. Like I was at a Parasvati Atra once, and in the back of the t-shirt, the devotee had said, I belong to Krishna. That's right. But we have this, even when we come to spiritual life, we still talking to you about this separatist mentality. That I have some self-interest or identity that's somehow different from Krishna. But pure bhakti, quote, the supreme occupation, dharma, for all humanity is that by which men can attain to loving devotional service under the transcendent Lord. Such devotional service must be unmotivated and uninterrupted in order to completely satisfy the self. No other motive but to serve. That's really advanced. You do get that in the faith traditions, but you have to go down the mystics to get it. You don't find it in the churches, mosques, and synagogues ordinarily. Rather, you find, God wants you to be prosperous material. He wants you to be rich, and that's a sign of the favor of God, is that when you make it materially, that's the sign you really make it. What does it say in the Bhagavatam? Just the opposite. Yasya anganudadami. When someone's very sincere, but also very entangled materially, my special mercy is I take everything away from this person. So he's forced to just come to me, depend on me, serve me. And that's the first problem in Krupa, when his business was failing. And he was realizing, you're destined to be a rich person, all right, but not the way the stars and the palms say. Krishna had another idea. Prabhupada told us, Krishna sent me to your country, a pauper, a poor man. That worked in his favor to become rich spiritually. It endeared Prabhupada to us even more. That, this person is so wise and kind and holy, but he's come down to the depths, to preach for us. Whereas all the other yogis that went uptown were the hoity-toities, the slang and things, the rich people. So Prabhupada didn't do that. But then Krishna made him rich, more rich. He could go anywhere in the world and stay, anywhere in one of his temples, right? He had thousands of followers and so much Lakshmi at his disposal, so many books published. But how was he living? I would ask his servants sometimes, what's it like to live with Srila Prabhupada? What's it like? You know Trivikram Maharaj? He goes to Poland. So I asked, I know the first time I asked that was Trivikram Brahmachari. And I asked him that, because I knew I heard he had served Prabhupada in England at John Lennon's estate. And so Trivikram just smiled and he said, believe it or not, Prabhupada is the simplest person in the world. He's so simple. He just does the same things at the same time.